affords me the opportunity to work with students from time to time as they put together senior projects. And the young man that you're all here this evening to support, Zing, came to me early on and said, "Hey, I got this idea. I think it could be fun and really interesting, and is it something we can pull off?" And I said, "Holy cow, this sounds like a lot of fun. We should totally do this." So he did. Now, as senior projects go, sometimes students come in with these huge ideas and they don't always land. You know, they for one reason or another, it could be a technical thing, it could be a, who knows, time crunch, just too much on the plate. But what I'm going to tell you is that this young man undertook a huge endeavor and landed it with like grace and talent and humor and a whole lot of attention to detail. So he came to me and said, "Hey, I want to record these things, and then I want to do some of this, and then, oh, by the way, I'm kind of an artist too, a graphic artist, and I do these other things, and kind of try to incorporate all this together." I said, "That sounds like a lot." And he said, "I think I can manage it." And I said, I believe in you, but I might pull the ripcord at some point if it gets too deep." And he's like, "All right." Well, oftentimes through that experience, a student will meet with me every other day, call me in the middle of the night. "Hey, this young man, I think, checked in with me maybe half a dozen times through the semester. He's like, is this all right? Am I doing the right things?" I said, "Yeah, man, keep going." "All right." And he'd come back, "All right, yeah, still going? Is that okay?" And I said, "Yeah, man, this is great." And it was great all the way through. Like, you know, there were very few comments that I would add other than, "Hey, maybe try this, or maybe swap that, or maybe, I don't know, try this or try that." And he would, which is says a lot about him too, because a lot of young people are apt to take the easy road sometimes, or, you know, maybe I can just skate by here or kind of cut this corner. Not this young man. And you're going to see a presentation this evening that is evidence of all of that. The amount of detail, the amount of work, the amount of effort, creativity that has gone into this project is really remarkable. It's commendable. I'm extremely proud of this young man and the work he's done. And I feel like I've made a friend through this experience. I already had a lot of respect for him already, but I feel like I've made a friend through this. And just an incredibly talented young man. And I'm really excited to see where it goes. Now, having said all that, the first part of the presentation, as you can tell by the program that you may have picked up on the way in, is a sort of lecture presentation where he's going to detail the scope of his project and how he made it work and all the various steps that he took. And then the second half is going to be a performance where he's invited many of his friends and colleagues and some of his professors from his time here at UNG, and they're going to perform a number of tunes for you that kind of range through a wide range of genres, things that he's been attached to throughout his time here. And it's really entertaining. I've heard these recordings because that's part of my job is to sort of supervise that. But I had no idea what I was getting myself into when he took the stage this afternoon for a sound check. And I was like, this is awesome. This is so entertaining. Just so full of joy and good humor. And you could tell there's a lot of love in the ensembles in which he's working. So having said all that, ladies and gentlemen, you're going to get a QR code towards the end of his presentation that is a link to his Bandcamp and his SoundCloud and all these things. And I say this because he's a musician and an artist, graphic artist, about to enter into the world. And I don't know if you know anything about the income opportunities for musicians and graphic artists going out into the world, but they are not guaranteed. And I don't know if you know this, but the young man's about to get married, like in 2 weeks, I think is the time. So congratulations. Woo! Sorry, that wasn't the clap. I said, come in when you can clap. That wasn't the clap. But I just have can excel that. If you get a chance to meet his betrothed, she is a delightful young lady, and I'm very happy for both of them. Now, I say all that because there's going to be a QR code that comes up towards the end that's for his Bandcamp, where if you wanted to support a starving artist and a young couple that's just about to make their way into the world, that'd be a really awesome way to do that. So, we're not passing the hat or anything, but you know, there it is. So, having said all that, ladies and gentlemen, in his senior capstone presentation, Mr. Zanko.
Of this recording project I've been doing all semester long. So yeah, I'll jump into it. I'll be mostly over here for the remainder of the time. So to start out, kind of the purpose of this whole thing, as Dr. Walker also mentioned, was to kind of encapsulate all the different areas of study from my time at UNG. As he said, I've kind of been focused towards production and composition while I've been here. Just working on a lot of fun stuff, and so, and the two parts of that also, I've been taking an art minor while I've been here as well, kind of spending a lot of time in the graphic design kind of area, and also with printmaking and stuff, which is a process I'll explain later. But I wanted to show you some visuals for the spaces I was kind of working in for most of this semester. In this bottom left-hand corner, you can see kind of a little setup there with the monitors and the computers and all that stuff. That's mostly where I did a lot of the mixing for the project, and I'll kind of explain that process later. In the top right-hand corner, you can see some of the hardware and stuff that I was able to use this semester. It's very been recently purchased, and it was really cool to use real tools like that, because I've always used it digitally inside of a computer before, but having the real thing is a game changer in a lot of senses. So in the bottom right-hand corner as well, you can kind of see the recording space that I had to work with. Which is, all of this is kind of up above y'all in that kind of tallest part of the building. Cool. So this first part of the project, I should also explain too, it's three songs that I worked on in collaboration with people or on a certain subject and whatnot. This first one was a collaboration with printmaker and art major here, Sarah Blair. Printmaking, if you don't know, is the process of carving or etching onto a surface and then inking up that surface, and you can print it multiple times as a way of reproducing an artwork. And she was working on a relief print series, which is the one where you carve away, say, a piece of wood or something. And the scope of this print series of hers was on the peace and serenity found within the kind of complexity and diversity of beauty that exists in these deep sea creatures. And she wanted to capture that, especially inspired by the Mariana Trench, by imitating these creatures visually and also kind of manipulating them and changing them with her own kind of insights and inspirations to show further how they brought peace to her. With that in mind, I asked her kind of some of her musical thoughts. I asked her about doing this collaboration, first of all, as kind of a way to create a backdrop and ambient soundscape kind of thing for a gallery setting, if you were to show these works in a gallery setting, and kind of to give it an audio side of things, to kind of place the viewer in that same space. She's a big fan of Studio Ghibli, which I don't know if some of y'all comment into that, what that is. It's an anime studio, and they have Joe Hisaishi is the main composer for that studio, and she really likes this particular one as inspiration. I'll show it to you. Swelling and strings and all that kind of thing. her, that feels peaceful, but also shows the seed side of things. Something I brought into it was actually from a friend, Caleb, recommendation of an artist, Nils Fromm. He's a minimalist composer. There's a lot of kind of ambient things for you can listen to while you're studying or if you're sleeping even. Some of it's very peaceful. This particular piece is called Muscle Memory, like the clam creature. I'll skip ahead to the middle because it's very slow and gradual, but you can hear it's a lot of like that kind of ocean noise you kind of assume, and these notes change very slowly over time. So going with that in mind, I kind of wanted to experiment with a lot of this stuff, and I don't know if Dr. Walker mentioned this, but I wanted to do things that, because most of my time I've done the production here, I've kind of spent a lot of time composing all the parts so that I could play them as well. So in this presentation, pretty much everything that you hear that's I recorded, I performed most of it too and wrote it specifically for me so that I could play it. With this first one is a synthesizer kind of thing for this first section of the piece you'll see later, but I just want to give you a clip of what it sounds like. Smooth string kind of sound, swelly, all those kind of things. In this bass line, it's kind of bowed on bass, kind of classically, is for one of the first creatures you'll see later. And then this last thing, it's a little pizzicato thing, which means to pluck in Italian, essentially. And it's in 5/8 time, which 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that kind of thing, because the creature that it's emulating is this five-legged squid crab thing we'll see later. So here's what it sounds like. Intro kind of to the piece. A lot of this is going to be snippets and pieces. I don't have time to show you the whole thing, but this first thing I'm going to show you is kind of setting the stage for the whole thing. It's an intro to these three main movements here, and it's kind of like a beach scene, a little more intense sounding than the rest. It's kind of showing the transition to the piece that she finds in the sea, so I'm going to play it right now. And this section's all synthesized. It's all done. Added a few things to it and changed a few things, but it's hard to explain how complicated that print is. It's got several layers. It's what's called a reductive relief print, where you carve away multiple layers, and each layer you ink it differently to provide all those colors, she did phenomenal work with that registration system, but here's kind of what that sounds like. It's very swelly. Thank you. Kelly in the evening makes me cry is much different. it's intentionally messy, as these next two songs are, because they have lyrics. I wanted to remove anything personal or self from it so that I could invest a lot, so that I wouldn't invest too much creatively into it, and to allow it to be more academic and so that I could learn these things that I wanted to learn. So it's very goofy, and it's based off of sometimes a goofy song will come to my head and I'll record a little voice memo of it. This is the original voice memo, and it's very telling, so.
The butter jelly in the morning tastes real nice. The butter jelly in the evening makes me cry.
So that's the trajectory we're headed in. This next part, I kind of honky-tonk 60s country kind of stuff is one of my favorite kind of things. Listen to it a lot. And I drew a lot of inspiration from particular songs for the different parts of the song that as I was writing it and performing it and stuff. So this first thing I'll talk about is the drums on Loretta Lynn's Don't Come Home With Drinking With Loving On Your Mind. Listen to the drum part in the beginning. It's pretty sparse and continuous. You'll hear it. Cool. So you hear how it's like pretty clicky. All that stuff there. So this is kind of an imitation and inspired by part of it. You can kind of get the picture there. This next part with the fiddles, this was more of capturing the kind of timbre and tonality that was in this original recording. It's a Red Foley and Ernest Tubb collaboration from the 50s or sometime in there. It's called Too Old to Cut the Mustard. very shrill. Yeah, it's a great song. and then this is kind of the sound I kind of came up with that's similar to that. Last one is the dobro sound from You're Looking at Country. This one's more so the compositional shape of the dobro line rather than the sound of it, because as you'll hear, this recording's a lot kind of lower and warmer sounding. Mine's a little more bright and in your face. And then this is the dobro part from this song. It's in your face and it's loud. But anyways, he was singing that, and we like ended up changing the lyrics over time, and we passed by Big Creek Distilling Co. So we said, Big Creek Distilling Co. And then we drove right past that, and there was a mailbox that was shaped like a bass, and we said, got a bass on my mailbox, baby. So this is what the original clip. We sat down and kind of recorded the song.
Big Creek Distilling Co. Got a bass on my mailbox, baby.
This one, in terms of production, I kind of learned a new trick. It's hard to hear on these speakers when I tested this out earlier, but I was in this snare sound in particular, which is like a boom, the kind of clapping sound you hear in a drum set. It was a little too flat, and it didn't really cut through the mix like it should have, which I'll play for you now what it sounds like. And so I learned this process by recommendation of Dr. Walker, where you can essentially take the recording and use it to trigger samples of other recordings and layer it all together, which is hard to explain, but essentially you can make it sound like another instrument by layering it with other sounds too. So it's hard to hear the difference on here, but I'll play it for you. It's a little brighter and it cuts through a little bit more in the final bit. And then another thing with electric guitar that I've kind of learned from being around people that are familiar with kind of Nashville, current Nashville, modern country techniques, and also with the CCM kind of stuff that goes on there, which are very kind of intertwined in a lot of ways. They often do with their electric guitar sounds, they turn the amp all the way up, put it inside of some kind of box, and then cover the whole thing up. They have like whole things made for it. They're called like lockers and stuff, but I kind of wanted to emulate that kind of thing and experiment with that sound because it fits into this genre. And here's kind of, it makes it a lot more compressed and kind of forward sound. But here's something I came up with. And yeah, here's a little bit of the finished product. And the guys too, in the recording session, it was very funny. And because each one of these guys has such an amazing sense of humor, but they were insistent that I made a producer tag, like what you would see for a SoundCloud rapper or something. So I made a producer tag from some bloopers from that recording session to kind of mix it all together.
This is an insane production.
it's something else. So here's an actual tune. I'll play a little good chunk of it.
Rolling down with the boys today, piled in the front seat, pretty in my pay holiday. Everybody and their granny are here.
To try out making a poster for the event, making a t-shirt for the design for the event, and also like an album cover design for it. And I kind of wanted to go in this folky style, and I got a lot of guidance from Professor Daniel Kornrupf. He's the art advisor kind of for this side of the project. And these are the sketches I came up with. materials I used along the way. This is kind of the printmaking thing I was talking about earlier. You can see in the bottom left-hand corner, those are the tools I would use to carve the wood. And in the top right corner, you can see the materials and the designs that correspond to them. In the top left, you can see the wooden board and the white spaces where I've carved away with the wood. And then in the middle and the right, there's those two, it's called gamuben sheets. It's a Japanese material made specifically for this. It's similar to vinyl or linoleum. And then in the bottom right-hand corner, you can see kind of the inking process as you go. This one was a layered print, so I did all of those color things first, and then I put a whole layer of black on top of that. But I would have to carve away everything that I wanted to stay the color that was underneath, if that makes sense. And here's the finished products on the next slide. So you can see on the left, that's the poster. There's some of those around still. And then also in the top right, you can see the t-shirt design, and then in the bottom right, it's the album cover design. In general, I kind of had to simplify some of the design things, especially with the shirt and the album cover were done pretty quickly. We want to do something quick. And I also kind of changed trajectory with them from being about the event to something instead that I could use as merchandise perhaps after school to kind of use for other things as well. And another comment too, I was having a really hard time, as you can see, with these little designs down here that required emblems from the university that you have to have on a poster in order to post them on campus. And I could not carve that small of detail, so I ended up with a workaround of using like a white gel pen and got those designs, and it worked out all right. Are there good questions? I've got several minutes here we can talk. Let's start with audio questions first. Does anyone have any questions or comments about that? Yeah, what's up?
What the law did you use?
I used Logic Pro, which is kind of the Apple. He asked what kind of DAW did I use. It's a digital audio workstation, which is essentially the studio compacted into a computer form. I used Logic. Any other questions? Yeah, Coop.
What kind of physical audio equipment did you use?
So, as you saw on this first slide, there's some of these things here in the top right-hand corner. This is just, I used three main things up there. It was that, it's called a preamp. It's where you put the microphone in first to adjust the signal coming in, boost it or attenuate it in terms of volume. And then each one of those gray knobs, you can actually do an EQ there, which is like on your car radio or stereo, you see the treble and bass knobs. This is like this, a little more flexibility with it. You can control specifically what the frequency bands are changing. And that allows you to kind of shape the sound to fit it largely overall, which I forgot to mention earlier. Mixing as a whole is the idea of taking these recording tracks and affecting them in different ways to allow it all to kind of glue together to a good recording that doesn't sound too busy, and how you can also hear every single part within that recording. From that preamp, it goes into a compressor, which was a Heritage Audio, I believe. This is a Warm Audio brand, and then it goes into a Heritage Audio EQ, multi-band EQ, which has a lot more bands on it that I can adjust that EQ with. That's the physical hardware I use. And then in terms of mics, there was a few Neumanns, a couple Bluebirds, and the RE20. Yeah, that's essentially it. Yeah. Any other questions about audio stuff? Got two over here. I'll start with one further back.
How long did it take you to learn the software and hardware, like, to where you're at the point you are now?
I started with the software side of things, kind of because we had a computer back home that had like GarageBand on it, and so when I was younger, I would play around with that sometimes, and then I didn't really take it that seriously until maybe when I was graduating high school. I bought a nice laptop and started working on Logic then. I'd say pretty much over the 4 years I've been here, I've been working on the digital side of things. In terms of hardware, the microphone stuff, I didn't really do that until I came here, and the hardware stuff wasn't until this semester, really. And then the question.
You said some of this hardware was brand new. How do you choose what hardware you use?
Are you talking about me, or like if I were to get the hardware for myself? Or how did that, okay. So the university purchased this stuff for this particular kind of department that's growing right now with the recording and Each one of these machines is like simple as it seems and as metal as it looks. Each one has a very distinct character to it, which is extremely subtle, and you have to have years of experience. And I'm still learning how to hear those differences, but they can make a significant difference in the way that you apply them, the way that you use them. So yeah, that'd be a good question. So, any other audio questions before I go to Art?
So when you're talking about the fiddle parts,
yes,
and trying to get the Ernest Dub sound,
yeah,
was that post EQ or was that the way you mic'd it?
It was a little of both. And if you saw in that picture, this is actually a technique I learned when I was looking online. You can see the mic's behind my shoulder rather than coming at it straight on, which would make more sense. This way it actually kind of cuts out any breathing noise you'd hear from the person. The mic was right here going towards the fiddle, you'd be breathing directly on it. So that was one thing I did, but it didn't particularly affect the sound. That is a tube mic, which I've never used before, which has a vacuum tube, like an old TV or an old amplifier or something. It gives it a particular tone to it and a warmth and on the distortion side of things. But the sound I got was achieved through EQing on the physical hardware. And in general, on the whole project, I did a lot of pre-mixing rather than where I've done pretty much all my life thus far is post-mixing, where you record the audio and then affect it. I did a lot of affecting on the front end because I had physical hardware to do it with. So I would affect it, record it, and then it would basically be done. Whereas otherwise I record, then affect. Let's move on to the art side of things. Does anyone have any questions about that? I think that is a no. Cool. So, yeah, as Dr. Walker said, I'm moving on. I'm graduating this semester. I wanted to provide some methods of contact for those who don't have anything from me yet. I just made that Instagram account, where I hope to be, you know, keeping things up to date with performances and whatnot, whatever I'm doing. And then I also made an email account if you'd like to reach out, just keep in touch. And lastly, here's three QR codes if you want access to the capstone paper, which has a lot more detail in terms of recording, how I did that, specific details and knobs, what I turned and when and where. In the middle is both the two far right things. Those are both streaming platforms. And I made an account just for this project. Like, I'm not going to upload my own stuff there in the future, probably. It's mostly just for this capstone, to contain this capstone stuff. And one in the center is SoundCloud. It's a free streaming service that you can use. And same with Bandcamp. Bandcamp allows you to donate stuff on there too. But yeah, that's essentially it for the presentation side of things. We're going to take a 10-minute intermission or so, and then we'll come back and have the concert portion. So thanks so much. bit different from the classical stuff I've been focusing on most of my time here, kind of cello type stuff. But this opportunity, this semester, I kind of had the opportunity to try something new on the instruments. So that was that piece. This next one is a Mexican bolero song written in the 50s by a composer, Alvaro Carrillo. And I wanted to, this whole like rest part of the concert is kind of wanted to use it as a way to honor the mentors and faculty and friends and stuff from my college time that have made the greatest impact on me and taught me all kinds of things, and also, yeah, just created awesome learning environments for me. So on my left here, I have Professor Marcia Parr, who is new this past semester, and she has been an awesome teacher and instructor and pushed me in a lot of different ways and helped me to grow my technique and also encouraged me to try different and new different areas as well. And then on my right here, I have Professor Alvaro from the Spanish department, where when I took his class in sophomore year, he was just such a light in the classroom and a friend to everyone, and also just a fantastic teacher. So, this song's called Salvador Ami. And yeah, banjo's not in this genre, but I'm playing all that stuff. Yes, and also like she's from Argentina and he's from Peru, so we're all kind of like blending things together here. So,
no pretend, no
Silver Queen, which is kind of after Silver Queen corn, which is a variety of corn. I wrote this tune as kind of as an ode to my grandfather, Papa, who had passed away while being here at college, and he always wanted me to learn the fiddle, so this was a tune I wrote for him. The second tune is a traditional tune called Soldier's Joy. And I medley them together because Ann Whitley Singleton over here, she was the one that first taught me some stuff on fiddle, and this was the tune she taught me, so that would be kind of a sweet way to blend all these things together. On my left here, I have Bob Christmas, who's been a great friend and mentor in a lot of ways through church and stuff, and then I have Dr. Esther Morgan Ellis as well, who's provided me countless opportunities through conference participation and performance opportunities and all these kind of things. So I'm indebted to all these folks and grateful that they can join me. Hopefully I don't knock everything over. So there's a few surprises in this one, you'll see, but it starts out like this. Oh, sure, that'd be great. In a moment. back here on bass, I have Fish Luke, who's a great friend and mentor, also from church. Yeah, holding it down on bass. And on the banjo, I have a great friend as well, Bill Long, who's a phenomenal friend as well, and a great banjo player. And then, last but not least, we have back here Mr. Derek Dangle, who some of you may recognize. He's in our building sometimes, hanging out with Mr. Johnny, our custodian. Mr. Derek's one of the custodians at Barnes Hall, which is the next building over. He's a fantastic drummer, as you'll hear. So, yeah. Woo!
Peanut butter jelly in the morning tastes real nice.
which we have a few new faces up here. I'll introduce first Mr. Harper, who I wanted to do this song with because in one of our voice lessons one day, his ringtone went off, and it's this song, Strawberry Letter 23, which is by the Brothers Johnson. It's a 70s funk song, and it's a lot of fun, and we both kind of connected over it because we both know it. And I asked him if he would sing it on this, and he said he would, so, which is very cool. Back here we have Dr. Walker on drums. He's been my project advisor and amazing help, and lots of wisdom from him this semester. I'm very grateful for it. And Dr. Chapman over here on keys, an amazing guy. If you haven't gotten a chance to meet him, he's a bundle of joy always. He always has lots of joke time in that whole time. Parts where y'all want y'all to sing along if you're willing to. Do you think y'all are?
Yeah.